go fix it. I ride through the hood cause I'm good. Hop out and I kick it. They say I'm a heathen. I've been ballin' all season. Saving souls, tryna reach one. 5 and 6 so they can't see none.
Demons run up and get murdered. Walk in the building and turn. I be so fresh like detergent. Stay in the cut like a surgeon. 24-7, I'm working. I'm creative with all of my verses. Wake up early, I'm up to the service. Redberry strikes, Mr. Belly. Just take a trip out to Cali. Yeah, I always take on the challenge. I make it shake like some jelly. Yeah, all my brothers, you not like a rally. Ain't none on my guy, can't manage. Yeah, I spit them bars like a felon. I seen them haters get jealous. I seen them haters get jealous. Ooh, and I already know they don't love me. They don't even know what it made me do. It was making me look at them funny. I was just grinding hard for the crews. And my brothers, we gon' get the money. I can't even take my little boy to school, cause I feel like he ain't gon' learn nothing. I saw this guy cause he got me through.
I ain't really rushing on the bridges. Got a bad little miss. No, I'm not wasting no time. Gotta pray for the wicked. The devil say he really won't smoke. That my cue to go fix it. I ride through the hood cause I'm good. Hop out and I keep.
Lately I've been on the road, ayy. I'm on the go. So many places to go, ayy. But it's only one road.
Gotta be patient, I'm taking my time, no.
You already know. He filling my cup and he running it over.
Yeah, I'm high for spirit, but gotta stay sober, ayy. Throughout the old body, new body got me chopping up them demons karate. Working on my salvation, Pilates. Crossed over like AI, ain't talking robotics. All this television got them hypnotic. They lost in the metaverse, out here wildin'. I'm dripping Jesus like ranch on a salad. Straight out the bricks, used to sleep on the pad. Told them save all the tricks for the kids, Lorette. Pull the 66 books off the hip, let them have it. No, I'm not Randy, I grew up a savage. I was washed by his blood, now I'm no longer average. Ay, so many blessings, I see it today. Everything fresh, but them haters gon' hate. Got the word of my heart, thanks to Jay. Yeshua, he making sure everything's straight. Out the gate, I'ma testify. Been through so much pain, been through plenty trials. All these miracles, boy, don't you minimize. Just resist the devil, he tell plenty lies. When you out of bounds, you get penalized. When you in his arms, that's how I survive. Try to
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Are you ready?
Summer family, stand up on your feet. If you worship with us online, stand up on your feet wherever you at. For the Lord delights himself in the praises and the worship of his people. Are you ready? I just ask you, are you ready? Remix is ready. Let's go. Let's go! Let's go! Everybody clap those hands! Let's go! Let's go! Everybody clap those hands! Yeah, yeah!
Come on, put those hands together. praise the Lord, I'm free. Everybody say,
I am free.
Oh, oh, oh,
praise the Lord, I'm free.
Everybody say,
I am free.
Redeem my soul. Oh, praise.
set the captives free. Yeah.
Oh, praise the one
who is the Lord of hosts.
Crossover. We give you glory, God.
give you honor. Oh,
that he is an awesome wonder. When you think of all the wonder. Contemplating you never goes asunder. Holy Spirit, you never slumber. You were the sheep when I plunder. Crushing me just like thunder. Bear witness to my spirit. Knowing you never has a limit. Keep nothing from me, don't prohibit. Our message is so pure, no one listen. There is nothing like when you come for a visit. You reign, understanding when it rains. You will not need you, pulling on the reins. I can't just be, you put a ring on my finger. A new sin has blown you, taking away my shame. So I give you my praise right now. Take me higher than ever before into the glory cloud. Like way right here now. Then all take the time and then worship you now.
I'm standing here and I don't even have to think about it, but my body knows to breathe in, breathe out. That's a miracle. And Lord, because of that, I'm amazed by you. That as I'm standing before you, my mind knows to work a certain way so that the words come out and they make sense. You know, there's some people in this world that don't have it and they're in different institutions, but the Lord called and saw fit that today I'm able to stand here and the words come out and they come out in order. They make sense. That's little to us, but that's a big, big miracle that we see day in and day out. And God, because of that, I'm amazed. I look across the room and, man, there's different colors, skin tones, nationalities, cultures, backgrounds, income. There's so many varieties in this room, and we can't have this everywhere in the world. So I don't take that for granted, and because of that, God, I'm amazed. Forget to take those moments and pause, breathe. All of you got here safely. no accidents. Your car started. You had a full tank or enough gas to get here. Lord, I'm amazed by you. And how many prayers have you been on your knees for? Can you count them? How many of them he's answered? Can you count them? I can't count mine. They're countless. And because that, I'm amazed by you. So, Lord God, we take this time right now to honor you, to glorify you. Lord God, our series is about this is how we do it. But, God, we just talked about how you do it. Day in and day out. You never fail on us. You never quit, Lord God. That's how you do it. That's the God I serve. That is how he does it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo, let me calm down before I get in trouble. Let me calm down. Lord, thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord God, bless each and every person that is in this room or under the sound of my voice, whether they're watching online or they're here or whether they'll watch later, Lord God. Touch them. Meet them where they're at, Lord God. Heal the sick. Mend the broken, Lord God. Meet every need, Lord God. And I pray that you would go before our pastors and our pastors that are here visiting with us. God, be in their lips, Lord God. Lead and guide the way. I know that we come in and we're prepared and we have an agenda, Lord God, but we open up and allow you to have your way, whatever that looks like. Because I know there's someone in this room that came with great expectation. And I know that expectation will be met. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And we seal this all with a roaring amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hey. Woo. Listen. Woo. Man. God. Golly. Woo. Look to your neighbor, give him a high five and tell him you are in the right place at the right time. Hallelujah.
So listen, we want to party with you. We want to celebrate that you're getting baptized today. So are y'all ready? Y'all ready? Yeah, come on, Crossover, make some noise for all those baptisms, those people that publicly stood up and said, I am following Jesus. Woo! Wow. 73 baptisms last week. Man, and we are celebrating each and every person. That brings the total here since we've been in this old Toys R Us building the past 13 years to almost 2,000 people that have gotten baptized here. It's crazy. And listen, every single one of those faces that you saw, there's a story, y'all. There's a story, and there's some powerful stories of some people that have said yes to Jesus that got baptized just last Sunday. I mean, we don't know every single story in detail, but we know some people, like, walked away from all kinds of crazy lifestyles, and now they're serving Jesus. People that walked away from addictions and from brokenness, and now God is putting them together, making them whole and healed. Come on. Man, I just get excited, y'all. Listen, if you don't know me, if you're new here, I'm Pastor Tommy, the lead pastor. So grateful you guys are with us today. I know we got a lot of new people in the building. Crossover family, make some noise for all the new people, all of our guests. Welcome you. If you guys are worshiping online with us, we want to say welcome to you guys as well. Type in the chat where you're watching from. We have thousands of people that tap in on a regular basis and watch us from all over the world. And so give it up for the online people as well. Thank you guys for tapping in. How many of y'all just enjoyed worship? Man, we have amazing talent here, amazing people that, it's not just talent, but people that have a heart to worship God and usher in God's presence. So our Remix worship team, they do such an amazing job every single week, week in and week out. Let's show some love for them as well, some appreciation. We got my man DJ Knock One back there on the turntables as well today. Our resident DJ. And listen, we worship the God through our singing and through our voices and through our hands lifted up. And another form of worship is we get to give back to God. And this is the opportunity to give back a portion of what he's given to us. And you can see what God is doing here at Crossover just from that past video. When you sow a seed here, when you give towards God's work here, God's moving here. This is a great place to spiritually invest, right? So if you're going to make an investment, a lot of times you want to do some, like, vetting and some due diligence. Is this a good place to put my finances, my hard work money, right? At the same time, when you're investing in God's kingdom, of course, you're giving it to God, but you also want to say, hey, is this a place that I know that God's work is happening? And I could tell you that as the lead pastor that's been here for 22 years, our leadership team, like, takes every dollar, every penny, and we try to maximize it to do the most work for Jesus. And, you know, we put out an annual report. We're going to be giving that out to you guys very soon from last year. We give the details of everything that happens. We're very transparent with that. And you could just see evidently looking around all that God is doing. And so if you guys want to join us today in giving, the ways to give are going to be up on the screens. And so we don't pass a bucket around anymore. So you guys can give digitally. The Crossover website is crossoverchurch.org, crossoverchurch.org if you want to tap in that way. If you want to give through our app, the app is Crossover Church. You can search that in both of the app stores. We love everybody here, Apple, Android. You know, we got a little bit of everything here. We're multi-phone, multi-ethnic, multi-generational. Everybody's welcome at Crossover Church, although one phone's better than the other. It's okay, but you know, you could tap in that way and give digitally. You could text to give as well. If you want to give physically today, we don't pass a bucket, but there is a drop box in the back of the room, and there's an offering envelope in the back of the seat. So if you want to give that way, you could just drop it in the box before you leave today. So I'm going to go ahead and pray for our time of giving, and I just want to say thank you for your generosity, and you can see what God is doing here at our church. I'm so excited. So excited about today. Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, and God, we thank you for your generosity to us. The Bible says that when we refresh others, when we're generous, when we give, you refresh us. And I know there's so many stories around this room and in rooms that this is streaming out to all over
of people that have been generous and they've trusted you with their offering and with their tithe, and you've taken care of them. You've provided. You've done miracles. So, God, I pray for every person that is given something today. God, I pray you'll bless them. You'll take care of them. God, I pray for every need that's represented in this crowd. Some people might not be able to give today. I pray you'll meet that need. You'll open up a door. You'll touch them. And God, we pray for these donations, these tithes, these offerings, that you'll take them and multiply them to continue to further your work here at Crossover Church and around the world. And so, God, we lift these up to you before you in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, listen, I'm excited because I'm not preaching today. I get to sit back and relax. We're continuing the series next week. This is how we do it. The next 2 weeks, we're going to be talking. Today is going to be talking about marriage and family and relationships. Next week, we're going to talk about dating. Anybody dating in the room? Dating, courting, all that kind of stuff. Any single people in the room? Any single people? We're going to talk to y'all, too. So, like, you don't want to miss it. Come back. But today, somebody say today. We got some special guests with us, some really great friends of Lucy and I, great friends of Crossover Church. They've been here several times in the past. And listen, this guy's like my big brother. We regularly talk. And a lot of you guys know him from the past, from his music. But I want to also tell you, he's a pastor now. He's been a pastor for many, many years. And him and his wife, they pastor an amazing church, and they're going to talk a little bit about that. It is an innovative, pioneering church. They're one of the first in the world to do it like they're doing it. And so, come on, Crossover family. Y'all know who's here today. I want you to stand to your feet, make some crazy noise for Montel and Kristen Jordan. Give it up for them. Let's go!
Hey, 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 what's up, what's up, what's up? Hey. Crossover family, what's good? How y'all doing? Hey. Man, so good to see y'all. I'm going to move this up a little closer to the front, if that's all right. Mm-hmm. I think I want to be a little closer to you. Y'all could be seated. Go ahead. Y'all sit down. Good to see you. Good to see you.
Hey.
Happy Man, it's Sunday, good to be. Y'all. Good to be here with y'all. Happy Sunday. What's up, family? Why don't you come a little closer to me?
Amen.
Come over here a little closer to me. Yep.
All right. Okay. Let's see. Yeah.
You good?
Maybe.
All right.
Well,
y'all got them.
All right.
Swivel chair.
Yeah,
got some.
Yeah, man. I was like, whoa.
Move it around a little bit.
Hey.
Hey, I'm Montel Jordan.
And I'm Kristen Jordan.
And we are your extended family, your cousins from the ATL.
Yeah, we are.
In case you didn't know it. What Pastor Urban D just said to you, Tommy and Lucy are very, very good friends of ours. They are instrumental in helping breathe life and vision into what we are now doing in the virtual space. We spent some time out on Front Street in Sycamore.
That's a
street corner out here where before we had even ventured out in ministry, God had shared vision with us, and they partnered to come into agreement with what God was going to do with us, with our virtual space of Masterpiece Church that we virtually in about 22 minutes is going to be going live in Atlanta online.
Hey.
So welcome folks that are watching online here at Crossover as well. But I love that we get to do what we get to do.
Absolutely. So if you have a Bible or a electronic device on silent, in just a few moments, we're going to be reading from Habakkuk 2:2. That's the first half of the Bible, but closer to the end of the Old Testament.
Mm-hmm.
And although the scriptures will be provided on your screen, we invite you to hold the word of God in your hand because it changes things.
That's right.
As you are locating Habakkuk 2:2, I'm going to say a prayer over us for our time together today. Bow your heads with me, please. Father, in the name of Jesus, we love you. We bless you. We thank you. We are so grateful that we get the opportunity to share with your people.
Yes.
These are your people. This is your house, and you are ever present here, Lord. Lord, make us invisible. Let what they hear be your words. Let it be your heart that they see for them, Lord. And we thank you that everything that we do and say will be magnifying and glorifying to you, for you alone are worthy of praise. In Jesus' name we pray.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
I said amen. Amen. Well, we are in a series called This Is How We... Yeah. It's Some of y'all just backslid right there. Just, it's okay. We're going to do an altar call right at the end of service. You can get it all back right.
We got you.
We're here for you.
Hey.
No, but that's genius to use. This is how we do it. And as our leader said today, our worship leader said, this is how you do it, God. And so today we specifically are going to be learning about marriage and relationships. That's our passion. And so if you're a note taker, our subject for today is having a vision for your family, having a vision for your family. Or you could say, this is how we do legacy. Easter was just a couple of weeks ago, right? You saw all those amazing baptisms that took place.
Y'all, that's a big deal.
It's a big, big deal.
That's a big deal.
And so I want to say that whether you've been saved for a long time or for a little time, meaning you've made Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life, we need to start growing towards not just being believers in Jesus, but to becoming disciples of Jesus and to have the faith to believe God for vision. Like, I believe you, God, that you're going to give me a vision, because walking into your next requires you to step out of your now.
Amen.
Can I say that again?
Please.
Walking into your next requires you to step out of your now. And before my wife reads this scripture, we have a picture of our family. I want to throw that family photo up real quick. You got that picture? So listen, I put this up here just because this is a photo that has our kids. It has our grandkids. We got four grandsons, our daughter. And we're talking about vision. And in speaking about vision, the story and some of what you're going to hear today is because at one point it was just me and Kristen and that little girl sitting on the chair holding a baby. And so when she was 4 years old, we had an opportunity to completely erase all of this.
That's it.
Like, we could have made a decision back when she was four. We could have made a decision to just shut all this down. Like, none of this would have existed if we had not made a decision to get God's vision for what family legacy looks like. So just hold on to that. Just tuck that away somewhere in your mind to understand, like, all of what you see, or this is like a big deal for us, and it's a big deal for you whether you know it or not, because the decisions that we make, the lines that we draw in the sand or that we don't, those are the things that could determine what your family legacy looks like.
And the truth is that I don't want you to draw a line in the sand. Today I'm going to have you draw a line in the concrete. Because the deal is that sand can be erased, right? And that's what the enemy sought to do here. And so what I want you to see is that you don't know what your future holds, but I guarantee you God's best for you is way greater than anything you could think or imagine. And so what I can tell you is that legacy happens when you say yes to God's will and plan for your life.
That's right. All right, baby, read Habakkuk 2 and verses 2 and 3.
All right. Habakkuk 2, 2 and 3 says it this way. Then the Lord answered me, write the vision. Make it clear on tablets so anyone can read it quickly. The vision will still happen at the appointed time. It hurries towards its goal. It will not lie. It will not be delayed. Wait for it.
Mm.
It will certainly happen. It won't be late.
That's good right there.
The scripture is a cheat code for establishing vision. Vision comes from God. Where does it come from?
God.
Amen. And it's our job to do this. Write the vision. Write it down. That means write it with your hands.
Mm-hmm.
Make it plain. Keep it in plain sight so you can see it at all times and speak it.
That's right. And here's what's important. When you say that's a cheat code, that scripture literally is a cheat code. For you can use that formula in almost any aspect of your life. Writing the vision, making it plain, and then speaking it. It's a cheat code for your business.
It's
a cheat code for friendships. It's a cheat code for finances. All of those things, if you write it, and you make it, keep it in plain sight, and you speak it, those things will work because it's the word of God. And here's the thing. If you look at someone else's marriage, like people will look at our marriage, and, you know, we're going on 30 years in June. We'll be married 30 years to each other. We'll be married 30 years to each other in June.
Gotta
you got to say that. And people can look at our marriage and say, oh, I want a marriage like that. And we're like, don't say that.
Don't say that.
Don't ever say that. Because there's a cost.
You may not have the anointing for that.
There's a cost that comes with everybody's journey and everybody's story. But here's the deal. When you can look at someone else's marriage or someone else's finance or someone else's business or someone else's success or someone else's followers or someone else's social, when you can see somebody else's, that's not vision. That's called sight.
Amen.
Because you can see it.
That part.
Vision always comes vertically. Somebody missed that. Vision always comes vertically. Whenever you're seeing something horizontally, that's great. It can influence, it can encourage you to have and to desire and to want to build or this or that. But vision will always come vertically, and it comes from God. And understand that, that first part of Habakkuk says, and God answered me. It said, the Lord answered me. That's where vision comes from. It comes from God because he answers. And when he answers, what happens is we get to want what he wants more than what we want.
Woo!
You get that? So we're talking about family vision
here.
Because
those are different sometimes.
For sure. Yeah, you don't always want what God wants.
Hey.
Sometimes you want what you want.
Listen, shake it off. I'm going to tell you the truth.
That's the real deal. Talking about vision for your family. Kristen and I, one time, we took a trip to North Carolina. It was not an expensive trip. We like literally just rolled out, got a little hotel in North Carolina where we could spend a couple of uninterrupted days where we could just have some good meals, just kind of chill out, to pull out devotionals, get in the Word of God, and literally spend some time. Like literally we had like 2.5, almost 3 days of just focused, God, we're going to seek your face for vision. And during that time, God gave us vision for our marriage ministry. He gave us vision for church. Like literally, we can go back and look and be like, oh, you're going to have a church and it's going to reach the virtual space. And none of this existed back then.
Facts.
Because we wrote the vision.
Made
it plain so people could quickly be able to read it and run with it. And then we began speaking it. We also did this for our family.
That's
we
it.
Did this for our kids. We did this for our grandkids, not even knowing. Like, if you go back and you look at that, it's crazy.
Because crazy thing, they didn't exist yet.
Yeah, no
grandkids didn't exist yet. Only one of them.
Yeah.
And now we have four.
Yeah.
But it's crazy because that's what God will do. He'll give you the vision because you're speaking into existence those things that are coming. And the thing is that when it comes from him, you know that it shall surely come to pass. And it's always better than what you thought.
Absolutely.
Always.
Yeah.
Never fails.
That's right. And so we crafted vision statements for our children. That's I don't it. Know if you have a vision statement. For your kids, of what you believe. We documented our kids' strengths.
We did.
We went to scripture, and God gave us scriptures for each of our children and their names and what they mean. And literally, we can look to this day and be able to look and be like, God is faithful because we wrote the vision, we made it plain, and we began speaking it. So when I ask you, do you have a vision for your family? Now, what we're going to do is we're going to share with you our vision for our family. But understand what we're doing is this is to encourage you. This is to enlighten you. This is not necessarily the vision for your family because this is horizontal and you can see it, which doesn't make it vision for you. It makes it sight. And so understand that what we give you, you can then take and then go to God and say, well, now that I've seen God, what is your vision for our lives, for our marriage, for our family? And so our family vision is this.
We love intentionally, we are led by faith, and we live in unity.
Say it again.
We love intentionally, we're led by faith, and we live in unity.
That's right.
The vision allows us to love, pray, and fight for one another. Not fight with each other.
Right.
Fight for one another.
That's right. And so
and
what
we're better together.
We are better together. And so what we're going to do right now is we're going to discuss those three things that we've had as our family vision. Hopefully this inspires you or encourages you. The first thing that we put as a family thing is that we love intentionally. With intentionality, we go after God and we go after our family and everything is done super intentionally. And there are three ways that we love intentionally. And the first way is?
We celebrate big.
We
Listen,
celebrate big.
Go big or go home.
We celebrate big.
Listen, it might be an all-month birthday celebration, but truthfully what it is that we want to make sure that everybody knows how valuable they are.
Yeah.
I never want you to wonder, does this person really love me? Do they feel valued? You will feel loved. You will feel valued.
It's somebody's birthday in my house right now, and it ain't even their birthday.
Facts. Listen,
like, it ain't their birthday,
balloons,
but we celebrating somebody's birthday
gifts,
just because.
Cake. Whoever. whatever you want at your birthday, you can have at your birthday. Whatever food you want at your birthday, you can have at your. This is the day you get to have it your way.
Like 3 weeks. Like 3-4 weeks. Now, I'm not saying everybody does that.
But that's how we do.
Here's what's important. A lot of people aren't celebrated.
That's it. They're
a lot
tolerated.
Of people on your job, you're not celebrated. A lot of people in your life, you don't hear good job. Or excellent, or God bless you for doing that. And because you're not celebrated, we want to make sure in our family we're super intentional that we are celebrating our family, we're celebrating our kids and our grandkids so they don't have to seek that validation from other people.
That's it.
From other relationships, from other places. Because there's people that are ready to validate you. You know what I'm saying? There's people
illegitimately.
Yeah.
And they'll take you down a path that is not God's path for
like
you.
Illegitimate validation.
That's it.
How can you put those two words together? Illegitimate validation. That's crazy. I never heard that.
And yet that's how the enemy plays, yeah. Right? So how God plays is that as you celebrate one another, you are reminded that you're celebrated, not tolerated.
That's right. So we celebrate big. What's another way that we're intentional about?
We communicate with each other. Listen, yeah. We have touch points. We have a group chat. And sometimes it's serious. Sometimes it's informational. Sometimes it's super silly. Meme fest. It's crazy.
We got like a group chat with the family, and we send stuff all the time. Now, some of y'all ain't probably talked to some of y'all relatives in a while, or some of your family members, or even brothers and siblings and stuff. You're not connected like that, and I get it. There are relationships, even with me, that I need to shore up and make those things a little closer, but we do like a monthly Zoom call with the family, and we get the mamas and the grandmamas, like everybody on the Zoom call, and it's super loud, and it's obnoxious, but still, it's a touch point because we're very intentional about celebrating. We're very intentional about communicating with each other. And then what else do we do, baby?
We congregate. We show up. Listen, we have a sprinter. We call it the honey wagon. And so, like, when we show up big. And everybody knows in our neighborhood and in our community, listen, if the Jordans are coming.
Don't invite us.
You're at least 13 deep. That's a minimum.
We're rolling deep. You want to come to dinner? Yeah, we got about 13. No, we're not going to do you like that. But we congregate.
Yeah, we are.
If the 4-year-old is getting a fuchsia belt in karate,
true.
Or the second grade promotion to third grade,
we still
roll like 30 deep. Like, they look out there, and you might have one grandmama or one auntie out there, and we be 30 deep in the back,
hey!
Like, yes, he belongs to us. He's
That's
ours
mine.
Right there. And everybody looking at us like we crazy. Geez. But we celebrate like that, and we congregate. Listen, I grew up in South Central L.A. where there was Crips and Bloods, and the Crips and Bloods ran thick. They ran deep, and I took that to my heart. And so we run. We ain't Crips and Blood, but we cover bottom blood. So
we
cover bottom blood, we might as well roll deep. So
Amen.
That's what we do. So we celebrate, we communicate, and we congregate, and that's the way that we are intentional. How are you intentional?
With your family.
With your family.
Absolutely. John 15 and 12 says it this way. This is my commandment. Love each other the same way that I loved you.
And how did he love us?
God shows up for us every time.
Yeah.
And that's the reason why we show up for each other.
That's
we
right.
want to look like God to each other. We want to be the example that Christ put here on earth to show others that we love them and show up.
That's right. He showed up for us, so we show up. That's the first thing that we do.
We're intentional.
The second way that we are giving vision for our family is we are led by our faith.
You better believe it. We're
led by our faith.
Faith leads us to hope, to joy, mm-hmm. and to peace.
That's right. And here's some ways that we're led by our faith. The first thing we do is we walk in authority.
That's it.
We walk in authority. As a family, listen, we got you know that when somebody not feeling well, when the 6-year-old is like, let me lay hands on you, grandma. Let me pray for you.
And they pray. But guess what? They pray with authority. Remember how God said that, listen, we're like little children? Let me tell you something. There's such a purity and a wholeheartedness about when they lay hands on you. And guess what? God shows up. You know why? Because he hears their prayers, and we're teaching them the authority that they walk in. When you walk in authority and you know whose you are.
Yeah.
Come on.
You walk different.
Come on.
You walk different.
When the 4-year-old can lay hands on you and say, and be healed in the name of Jesus and by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, I'm like, wait, what? You're 4. power. That's authority. Walk in the authority that God gave you.
Yeah. And in all the battles that a family can be facing, we understand,
man,
when you take your rightful position of authority, right, as a family, praying for each other, speaking the word of God over each other. And listen, some people, you pray for your family, you don't pray with your family.
Woo.
Somebody missed that. Some of you praying about your spouse and don't pray with your spouse.
Some of you praying on your spouse.
Ooh. And you're talking P-R-E-Y and not P-R-A-Y. Watch it now. Listen, there's a difference in praying for someone and praying with someone. And
that's
what we're
it.
Telling you is that when two or three are gathered together, God said, I'll be there
in the midst.
And so because of that, you have to use that. If you know it and don't use it, that's not wisdom. That's just knowledge. And knowledge without applying it is not very wise. And so the first thing we do with our family is we recognize we have authority and we walk in that and we speak it.
That's
and
it.
We take that. And we do it because there's something called warfare.
That's
and
it.
We warfare
that's
together.
That's a real thing, y'all. But this is the thing. We feel weary when we're fighting a fight without the weapons that we're activating.
That's
right?
Right.
So if we don't use our full armor, like putting on the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the sword of the spirit, listen, we have weapons. But if you show up to a gunfight with a knife, like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And the thing is that our sword is what we need in order to fight that fight.
That's right.
We have a real enemy who comes to seek, kill, and destroy.
He wants to steal,
and so
kill,
guess
and destroy.
What are we doing? If we don't show up with our word, if we don't show up with what we need to, I didn't want to say it, but
say
I'm going to say
it.
This is how we do it.
This is how we do it. You know why you and Pastor Tommy, both y'all act like y'all don't want to say that. We didn't name the whole thing. It's right there behind you. Hey, listen, you said something. Hey, y'all need to catch this. My wife said, and this is what the Bible said. It said the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. We say that like it's one thing. Like we always say, oh, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Because we say it together, it's one thing. It's not one thing. I can steal, and it don't mean I kill and destroy. You have an enemy that wants to steal. He wants to steal your joy. He wants to steal your legacy. He wants to steal your family. He wants to steal your finance. He wants to steal your peace. He wants to steal your marriage. That's not enough. That's not enough for him. It's not enough to steal that from you. After he steals it, he wants to kill it. He wants it to die. He wants your relationship to die. He wants your marriage to die. He wants your peace to die. And listen, even after it dies, that's not enough. He wants to destroy it. It says steal, kill, and destroy. That means the thing that he took from you and the thing that he killed, he wants to make sure that there's even no recognition that the thing ever existed, that your marriage never existed, that your family never existed, that your business never existed. And so when you got an enemy that hates you that bad, where he don't just want to steal it and he don't just want to kill it, but he wants to destroy it, you got to fight different. You got to fight different.
And this is the thing. You have to learn how to fight and how to warfare. How do we warfare? So in this last season, this is not on though, but in this last season, it's been crazy, y'all. I would like to tell you that this is an easy walk. This is not an easy walk. This thing costs, okay?
Yeah.
So what I'll tell you is that we learn how to warfare. How do you warfare? You stand back to back and you use that word. It is warfare. It is a weapon that yields fruit. When we wield fruit from the word that we speak, guess what? Every single day, I read scripture over him. I read scripture over our family. And then we say it aloud and we say it in unison because that's how we war and we win.
That's right. That's right. That's the third thing. We walk in authority, we warfare, and we win.
That's
and
it.
Some of y'all don't know that we win. So let me, spoiler alert.
That's it.
We win.
That's it.
Yeah, you missed that. See, we know how the book ends unless you don't know how the book ends.
Hey.
All right? And here's the thing, that the same way that, and this is so, it's happening in the world right now where, history, you know, some people want to erase books and just make sure the history is kind of changed and changed in world current events and that this is not really how this happened. This is really what, listen, y'all, the enemy also wants to do the same thing. He wants you to forget that you win.
That's it.
Y'all don't know this. Revelation declares that the devil is a defeated foe.
That's it.
Like he has already took the L. He is destined for hell. He's going to the lake of fire. And he wants to take as many people with him as possible. And here's the deal. The only way he does that, the only way you lose The only way you don't win is if you forfeit.
Hey.
Do y'all know what a forfeit is? A forfeit is where you potentially could have won, but you throw in the towel.
That's it.
Who does that? Who's winning the fight? It's already been fixed. The card is you in the ring. You may be getting beat up. The judges are already. I don't care how bad he gets beat up. I don't care how bad she's going to take it. She's already got the victory. We've already signed the name, and then you go throwing in the towel. I'm here to tell you right now, some of y'all, if you did throw in the towel right now, God would throw it right back in the ring. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to throw it. Just hold on to it. It's okay. It just came out. I'm sorry. If you threw in the towel, he would throw it right back in. Because he will not allow you to forfeit. That was a good catch right there.
Yeah, you was. Your reflex is good, sis.
Yeah. Don't forget we win, y'all. That's we it. Win. And then the third thing. Oh, hold on. Here's the scripture. Psalm 108 and 13.
It says, with God on our side, we will win.
Say it again.
With God on our side, we will win. He will defeat our enemies.
Listen. All we do is win, 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 no matter what. Got Jesus on my mind and my Jesus is enough. The Holy Ghost step up in the building. Everybody hands go up. And he stay there. And he stay there. And he stay there. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Because all we do is win, win, win. And if you a Christian, throw your hands in the air. Let them stay there. That's where your hot 16 was supposed to come in right there, Pastor. y'all playing like y'all ain't gonna hear that on the radio in a couple of weeks.
Hey.
Listen. Yes, yes, yes. And the third thing we do after being intentional and What did I say? Being intentional, being led by faith, and then we live in unity.
That's it. We live in unity. Unity adds and multiplies. Discord subtracts and divides.
Yeah.
And that's not of God.
That's right. And so here are some ways that we operate as a family in unity. The first thing we do is we stay together.
Facts. Unity is imperative in triumphs and tragedy. Listen. One of the things that has happened for us is we've experienced a lot of tragedy and a lot of trials, but every single time we win. But I'll give you an example. Can you throw up that picture? In 2005, we experienced a house fire. Mm-hmm. And it was crazy, y'all. I'm going to tell you, this is a thing. So everything that we owned in this was in this house.
And listen, we own some stuff. Like, I've been to Grammy Awards and been around the NBA, had signed Jordan jerseys. Like, all the stuff that we had accumulated over all the years that we thought had value and thought we had worth.
That was crazy. The crazy thing is this, though. See, normally on a traditional day, we were having my oldest son's 16th birthday at the time and my dad's 60th. And the crazy thing was is that I was cooking tacos. Now, normally, my mode of operation would have been to cook and then go take a shower. However, on this day, for whatever reason, I took a shower and went to go cook. And while I was standing in the kitchen and I was preparing the tacos for these festivities, I see something orange out of the side of my eye. And it's the whole backside of our house that was on fire, except for we were in it.
Note to self, fire alarms don't go off inside the house if the fire starts outside.
Facts. Facts. So me, my two boys, my littlest boy was 18 months old. My son was turning 16. I'm freaking out because I'm trying to figure out where they're at. They're outside playing basketball. My parents were visiting from out of town, and they come running out of the shower, some things you should never see. I'm just saying. And we grabbed things. We literally, nothing. I had on cheetah slippers, jeans, a white T-shirt, and a red apron. That's what I walked out with. I tried to go back in for my ID. It flashed at me. I was like, ooh, never mind. I'm good.
Throw the next photo up in the meantime. You can see that? Yeah.
Yeah.
So you saw the side of it first, and then you see this right here. Like,
and the crazy part is, like, in this white thing right here, it looked almost like a chapel. Every creative piece of work that we had done, he had just finished a script for the book that we now have written, children's books, all kind of things in this space right here. And I was like, God, I think that this might take him out. So I'm going to tell you right now, I need you to intervene and do what only you can do. This whole house burned up. Now, mind you, what you don't see is that there's a house on this side and this side. Our neighborhood looked like Baghdad, y'all.
Two other houses burned completely to the ground, but our house stayed right here, so we were able to get our content out of the house. Just that, but like family, we were able to save family photos somehow, and the stuff, the books and stuff that was in that piece of the house. But here's the point why we're showing you that. We're showing you that because everything goes through fire.
That's it. That's it.
Somebody missed that.
That's it. But what you don't know is fire purifies.
That's right. That's right. And so you got to understand, if you're going through something and it feels like it is fire, it's not going to consume you.
That's it.
It's going to purify you. But the thing is, you got to allow the fire to do what it's supposed to do.
That's it.
You got to allow it to do what it's supposed to do. And so from that standpoint, during that time, we ended up not having a home. And so God led us to a space that was nearby. And at that time, what ends up happening is all the stuff we had that was now gone, we're now being purified. Our family is being purified. So the movie theater and the video games and all the stuff we had, gone. We got this little rental and one little TV and Monopoly board.
That's it.
And Scrabble.
That's it. Uno.
Uno.
Listen, and we learn how to be a family. We learn how to have dinner every night and talk to each other and speak and play games and be in each other's life and be intentional. And you know what it did? Although it looks like it destroyed us, it actually made us.
That's right. That's it. And so the first thing we do is we stay together. The other thing we do is we play together.
We play hard, y'all.
We play real hard.
We go hard in the paint.
The Jordans, we play. Because listen, we work hard so we can play hard.
Amen.
And that's a big deal. But we take vacation as a family. Every summer, the Jordans, we're going somewhere. Every winter, we're going somewhere. And it ain't got to be expensive, but it's got to be intentional, and we get away because we got kids aged 35 to 11.
Facts.
And the grandkids, and the only way we keep our family together for them to know each other is with their lives, our lives, this or that. Okay, yeah, but this week, we all going here. We're going to all be in the house. We're going to all play family games. We're going to all be poolside. And this is how the almost two-year-old knows the 35-year-old from grandsons and everything simply because we are very deliberate and very, listen, this is because we got vision. We got vision for our family. And this is something that we do. We stay together, we play together, and the last thing is we pray together.
There is power in agreement.
Yeah.
The word says he is there in the midst. Pray for your family. Pray with your family.
That's
right. It's imperative. Matthew 18 and 20 says it this way. Two or more may meet together because they believe in me. If they do that, I will be there with them.
That's right.
When we are in agreement, it invites his presence, and his presence changes everything.
That's right. So the question is your family unified?
Amen.
And if not, what things can you do to start? And it doesn't happen all at once, but what things can you start doing to bring more unity to your family? We know we can pray more to unity. You can worship more
together
with your family to bring more
unity. There's actually nothing more beautiful to me than when I hear my kids worshiping. Like, nothing will bring me to tears like hearing my kids worship the Lord.
Oh, it was so dope. We had a little moment in the house, at the house church a couple weeks ago where all the kids, you know, all the little kids or whatever were there, and they were just like in the living room because we got a house church, and they all, unprompted, are standing up on the fireplace and they're playing a worship song, the CC Winans song or whatever.
Man.
And they're worshiping
going
at the
in.
Top of their lungs, and they're emulating and putting their hands up and leaning from side to side. And we're just broken. Like all the parents is laid out on the floor, everything, because the kids is leading worship because they're watching and they're emulating and they are seeing the presence of God, and now they want to bring the presence of God, you know, into what they are doing. And so,
shout out to the Foxworths. Good parenting right there.
Yeah, Lincoln was getting it in. That's my guy.
I'm telling you, it changes everything. But they're looking at what you do, and that's what they're emulating. So if your child is acting a fool, heart check. The same.
They're not doing what they see you do. See you say they're doing what they see you do. Ephesians 4:3. What
does it say? Says it this way: Do your best to preserve the unity which the Spirit gives by means of the peace that binds you together.
Now, just so y'all know, one thing my wife is really great at is she'll take scripture, and because we don't just pray haphazardly, we pray the word of God because His word doesn't come back void, and so you take
ours
a scripture.
Might. Listen, ours might. So listen, when you say, I haven't had my prayers answered, what are you praying?
Yeah.
If you pray His word, I guarantee you it has to come to pass. Why? Not because I said so, because God said so.
It's His word.
His word never comes back void. So I would pray that scripture and I would say it this way. I would say, Papa, we will do our best to operate in unity given to us by your Spirit. That peace which binds us together keeps our hearts knit together. And I pray that in Jesus' name.
That's right.
That's not my prayers. That's His prayers. And that's why God's no respecter of person. He doesn't care if I pray it, if you pray it, if the baby pray it. Listen,
it's His word.
It's His word. It shall surely come to pass.
That's right.
That's it.
So I want to say thank y'all for allowing us to share the vision that God has given to us for our family. And I want to say, if you don't have a vision for your family, trust me, the world does.
Yeah.
If you don't have a vision for your family, the world does. And so today is a day that you can put into action, a plan of action to secure God's vision for your family. Because whatever you leave, whatever you leave, good or bad, that's going to be your legacy.
That's it.
You can leave good family legacy. You can leave bad family legacy. What do you want your family legacy to be?
That's it.
This is funny, quick story. Before we do an altar call, I want to share this story with you. We have a great friend who is super, super into finance. Like from
he's
the time he was super intellectual, and everything his mind thinks in money. His mind thinks in finance. And one day we were listening to the song, this famous song from the Temptations. Papa was a rolling stone. Wherever he laid his hat was his home. And when he died, all he left us was alone. And listen, first of all, that's a dope, as a songwriter, that's a dope lyric to say, when he died, all he left us was alone. And I'm talking to my guy, who's a financial guy, and he was like, man, my whole life, I thought they were saying all he left us was alone. Are y'all getting this? His financial mind had him thinking that man died and left them alone instead of leaving them alone. Now, why would I share that? Why would I say that? The point is, your lens can affect your legacy. See, if you have a poverty mentality or a poverty point of view, that deals with your vision. If you have a selfish point of view, that deals with your vision. Any point of view that you have outside of God's vision is going to lead to division, right? And our Father in heaven wants you to have His vision for your life. It says in 1 Corinthians 2:9, but Scripture says, no eye has seen, nor ear has heard. That means your eyes and your ears have not seen or heard, or your mind has not imagined the things that God has prepared for those who love Him.
Yep.
God has prepared a vision for those of you that love Him.
Yep.
And let me just say this. If you don't know how to love Him, the greatest way to demonstrate that is to allow Him to love you.
That's it.
To allow Him to save you. Allow Him to cleanse you. Allow Him. What I'm doing right now is casting vision. I'm casting vision. And I'm casting it because some things are taught, but some things are caught. Okay? And Romans 10:9 says this. If you would declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved.
Yep.
And maybe today is that day for you. Maybe today is the day of salvation.
Yep.
Maybe you'd like to make that decision today. Maybe you don't understand your outlook on life can be changed today. Your destiny can be secured. Your legacy can be cemented in paradise for all eternity today. And listen, I can't comprehend or understand what certain things look or feel like, because I know His ways are above
bigger
my ways. His thoughts are higher than my thoughts.
Yeah.
But here's what I do know. I know He has a vision for your life.
Yes, He does.
And I think you ought to want what He has for your life. I don't know if you'd be willing to make that decision today. If you would say, Pastor Montel, I'm apart from God, And I know even in a church that's as amazing as this, there may be someone here that you don't have a vision for your family. You don't have a vision for your marriage. We can pray for that. And we can pray God's word and he'll give that to you. But more than that, God gives vision to his sons and daughters. In other words, not everybody is his son and daughter.
Say that.
A lot of people get that twisted, Pastor. We say we're all God's children. We're all God's children. We're all God's creations. We're not all God's children. Somebody missed that. Listen, if I tell my kids we're going to Busch Gardens today, the neighbor's kids don't get excited.
That's it.
Because they're my kids. And what God has, the vision that he has, is for his sons and for his daughter. And just maybe today you don't recognize you're a son and you're his daughter. And so we want to do that today. We want to give you the opportunity to do that. And so that word said, if you would believe with your heart, you would confess with your mouth that Jesus was the Son of God, that he was raised from the dead, you'd be saved. You could make that decision today to be a son. You could make that decision today to be a daughter. And so I'm going to ask you just a moment, if you would bow your heads all over this room, we're going to pray in just a moment. But as you hear me talking, this ain't Montel and this ain't Kristen. I believe the Spirit of God is speaking to you right now in this moment. And it don't take a whole lot of pulling. It don't take no begging and pleading. It's just if you know that you're not sure where you're going to spend eternity, if you're not sure that you are a son or a daughter of God and you want to make sure, listen, there's a difference in knowing God and God knowing you. If you want to make sure that not only do you know God, but that he knows you and he knows you as his son and as his daughter, I'm going to ask you with all heads bowed, all eyes closed, if that's you and you say, I want to make sure that my salvation is secure. I want to make sure I got this thing sewn up. I want to make sure I got VIP in heaven. I don't want to get there in the list and not know if my name is on it. I want to know for certain that I have eternity covered. If that's you, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to ask you just to courageously, just lift up your hand so I can see it. If that's you, praise God. Hold it up there just for a second. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God sees your hand more than I do, more than Kristen does, more than pastors do. Thank God for your courage. I appreciate you for your courage. Okay, you can put your hands down. Here's how we secure that right now. We're going to say a prayer together, and this prayer is not a finish line. It's a starting point for new relationship with your father who wants to claim you. He wants to adopt you. He wants to inherit you into the kingdom today. So if that's you, those of you who are believers and you know your security in heaven is safe, I want you to pray along with our brothers and sisters who are about to be welcomed into the family. Let's just say this together. Say, Jesus, I love you.
I love you.
You love me first.
You love me first.
You love me more.
You love me more.
I'm a sinner.
I am a sinner.
I need a Savior.
I need a Savior.
I believe. Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Is my Savior.
Is my Savior.
You came to this world.
You came to this world.
For me.
For me.
You died on a cross.
You died on a cross.
For me.
For me.
You went to the grave.
You went to the grave.
For me.
For me.
And you rose again.
And you rose again.
For me.
For me.
For me.
For me.
Come into my heart.
Come into my heart.
Drive out any darkness.
Drive out all the darkness.
Replace it with your love.
Replace it with your love.
Be my Lord and Savior.
Be my Lord and Savior.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
Now in Jesus' name, if you are able, I'm going to ask you to lift up your hands all over this building, watching online. If you are able, lift up your hands. Uplifted hands is a universal sign of surrender. And some of you are surrendering your life right now. You're surrendering your will. You're surrendering your way. You're surrendering your disbelief. You're surrendering your sin. You're surrendering the old you to the only one who knows what to do with it. And uplifted hands is also a universal sign of receiving, y'all. And so right now, you can be receiving love. You can be receiving forgiveness. You'll be receiving salvation. You can be receiving healing right now in the name of Jesus. And no matter if you are surrendering or receiving, just know God met you at crossover to help you cross over today so that he could give you vision as a son and a daughter in Jesus Christ. And everybody said amen.
Yes.
Amen. Come on, let's celebrate. If you gave your life to Jesus, we are so proud of you. We're so proud of you. Hey, do me a favor. If you gave your life to Jesus, you can text. I think it's 77411. Throw that up on the screen. If you gave your life to Jesus today, don't just leave. Don't just leave without doing something about it. That's the biggest decision you can make in your life. And I want to make sure that we get to celebrate and the church can come alongside of you and give you next steps to know what you need to do. Now that you gave your life to Jesus, you got to start walking the walk and talking the talk. Amen?
Amen.
All right. I think Pastor's going to be coming back out here in a second. Come on, Pastor.
Y'all give it up for Montel and Kristen. Beautiful. If you just pray that prayer and you do need to talk to somebody, you need some prayer, the prayer room's going to be open right over there to the right. Your right, you see them waving over there. If you're worshiping online, you need prayer, just type in the chat, pray for me. And Montel, before you leave, man, could you maybe bless us with a song? You can take this mic right here, man. You're going to take this mic. This is the good mic right here, man. Y'all want Montel to do a song, maybe?
I don't know whatever you could be thinking. What you need? What would y'all say if I said to you, I'm kind of buzzing, it's all because. Well, I didn't know that Tampa did is sitting down. Every place else I've been to in the world, they actually said, DJ, now, come on, baby, let's go. Give me some in the monitors. Come on, I can't hear it.
This is how we do it. Let's go, let's go. Sha-la-la-la-la-la.
Can I have some track in the monitors?
Sha-la-la-la-la-la.
Oh, well, it's okay to do it, y'all. It's safe in church. Come on.
This is how we do it. It's Sunday, right? And I feel all right. The party's right here in Tampa. So I reach for the old school when I turn it up. I designate a driver, take the keys to my truck. Hit the song and they played it. The honeys in the street say, money, oh, we made it. It feels so good in your hood. The summertime skirts and the guys that can eye on the gangbangers forgot about the drive-by. You gotta get your groove on before you go get paid. So tip up your cup and throw your hands up and let me hear the whole church say, I'm kind of buzzing, it's all because. Oh, crossover does it like nobody does. And to all my neighbors, you got much flavor. Let's flip the track in the old school back.
We almost there.
This is how we do it. Our hands are in the air. And wave one from here to there. If you're an OG Mac, oh, I wanna be player. You see, the hood's been good to me ever since I was a lowercase G. But now I'm with the big G. The girls see me got the money. And if you were from where I'm from, then you would know that I gotta get mine at Crossover Church. You can get yours at a six ball. Whatever it is, the party's underway. So tip up your cup and throw your hands. Crossover Church, I love y'all. I appreciate you. I believe in y'all. Your pastors love you. And it's an honor to serve you today. Amen.
Amen. My God. It's good to be with y'all, church family. Hey.
Come on, y'all make some noise one more time for my guy, Montel Jordan. Well, listen, if this is your first time in Crossover, this is how we do it. This is how we get down. So if it's your first time, we got a free gift bag for you in the center of the lobby. So make sure you go out there and pick that up. You got a brochure when you came in. Growth groups. Somebody say growth groups. Growth groups are starting this week. They're launching. Jump in a group. Get plugged in. We got some amazing groups that are happening, y'all. We love you guys. The Jordans are going to hang out there for a little bit if you want to get a quick picture. Say hello. We love y'all.
Take your time getting out of the parking lot. It's gonna be a little crazy today, but man, this is how we do it. God bless you. We out.
Thank you.